Next slide, please. And as usual, I will start with our epi curve, which is basically a graph showing all of the positive cases confirmed by PCR testing to date since the start of the pandemic. And you can see that we obviously had a huge surge with the most recent wave, represented by the highest peaks during January and into February from the Omicron variant. If you look to the right of the curve, you will see that our case rates have come down quite significantly and are looking very, very low. I will tell you that we now need to take this with a bit of a grain of salt because we know that more and more people are using rapid antigen tests and using at-home over-the-counter rapid antigen tests, which are not reported to public health or however, I do like to look at this curve to see trends. I would like to show you the next slide and just start by saying that if you look to the right side of this epi curve, I'm honing in now on that, on the latest few weeks. So if you look at the most recent few weeks of case rates per 100,000, you will see that, yes, we indeed declined rapidly out of the Omicron variant in the last weeks of February and beginning of March. And since then, around the middle of March, our case rates have remained stable at low rates, but not further declining. The blue line represents the state of California, which now has a case rate of 6.5, and the orange line is San Joaquin County, and we're now at a case rate of 3.9. So we have been below the state average for several weeks now as far as our case rate goes. Very hard to know the accuracy of these numbers, again, as I said, because of everyone doing different types of testing that's available. It does seem, though, that the state rate is higher than ours as it's been consistent, and I think a lot of that is driven by increasing case rates in Southern California and in the Bay Area, where the BA.2 variant seems to be driving some upticks. If you look at our case rate closely, you'll see that we're starting to tick up ever so slightly ourselves, so that we did have a case rate in the low threes a couple of weeks ago, 3.1 just a couple of weeks ago, and now at 3.9, we seem to be trending upward along with the rest of the state. So something to monitor, but as I said, globally, across nationally, case rates are a really nice low number at this time. Next slide. I want to show you with the positivity rate how this is also mirrored in our positivity rate per 100,000. Again, we're below the state's positivity rate of 2.1% at 1.6%. However, if you look closely, you'll see that we're starting to trend upward. So our positivity rate has started to drift upward. And this is probably driven by the BA.2 variant, which is what I will be discussing very shortly. It is now the predominant variant and is causing some slight upticks across the state and across the country. You may read in the news that the BA.2 variant and its sublineages are becoming a bit problematic in the northeast side of the country. Here in our state, it is obviously also the predominant variant. And it was expected to cause some little bit of an uptick, what we're calling maybe a blip, and we're hoping does not become a large surge. We're not really expecting it to become a huge surge. Perhaps it will just blip up a bit and then hopefully come back down again. Next slide. Since our numbers are probably undercount when it comes to case rate, it would more reasonable to follow hospitalizations to really see, even if we know that BA.2 is causing an issue with an increase in case rates, what are people looking like in the hospitals? And we have an all-time low of hospitalized patients right now with under 10 people in the hospital across our 7 area acute hospitals in the county who are hospitalized for COVID. So a very, very nice low number. Remember, though, that hospitalizations are a lagging indicator, and as case rates start to rise, hospitalizations are expected to rise 2 to 3 weeks later after the case rates rise. So just monitoring closely. We're not expecting this to become unreasonable or dramatic as the beginning of Omicron with the original Omicron variant. So right now, really looking good. Next slide. So the BA.2 is the predominant sublineage globally and in the United States. And if you look, it is the pink bar, and the most recent week shows that, according to CDC's numbers, it accounts for 85.9% of all sequenced specimens. And the rest, the darker purple, is BA.1.1 and the original Omicron BA.1.1.529. So it's all Omicron right now, with the BA.2 sublineage causing the most cases currently. Next slide. The CDC will break this down into regions. So again, with the light pink representing BA.2 and the darker purple representing the earlier strains of Omicron. And you will see, as I said, that the Northeast has a lot more BA.2. And now even our region, California's in Region 9, we also have 85% of our cases represented by BA.2. So predominantly the Northeast and Region 9. But across the country, really, BA.2 is the predominant variant. So next slide, we tried to look at what things are looking like in our county as far as the BA.2, and this is very preliminary data. As you know, sequences that go off to get whole genome sequenced take a week, 2-3 weeks even to come back for us to know what variant they turned out to be. So as you see, we are now showing more and more BA.2 coming back in our county, but these are very low numbers or very small samplings. But yes, BA.2 did arrive in our county. If you look at the week of April 10th, which is just last week, 100% of cases are BA.2. However, I will tell you that that represents one case. So we have one specimen returning to us from that week, and it was a BA.2. For the week prior, about 44% were the original Omicron, 55% BA.2. But we suspect that currently, we really are at least at 85% BA.2, along with the rest of Region 9. Next slide. So I wanted to explain a little bit more about this sublineage of Omicron. There are studies now ongoing and that are happening across the globe on BA.2. And what we feel about it is that it's likely more transmissible than BA.1. With each successive variant, we have seen that each variant attains growth advantage over the previous variant. So we've seen this when Omicron was more transmissible than the Delta variant by 50%. And now we're seeing that the BA.2 sublineage is more transmissible than BA.1. Some studies showing that it's 10% more transmissible, 20% or up to 30% more transmissible than BA.1. So clearly more contagious and causing some problems in other parts of the globe, but perhaps not here in our country or in our state, because the severity caused by BA.2 appears to be similar to BA.1. There are studies out of South Africa and the UK and now Sweden that are showing that it is a mild acting disease, much like BA.1. And so that is why we're hoping that our hospitalization rates do not rise dramatically as BA.2 becomes more and more dominant. And then early data suggest that having had an infection with BA.1 provides protection against reinfection with BA.2. So in Denmark, there were a huge problem with the BA.1 Omicron variant. They then followed the BA.2, which they had another wave of. And it seemed that people who had the BA.1, so early Omicron people who got infected, had less of a chance of becoming infected with BA.2. It does happen, but it seems to be rare and, again, mild. Vaccine symptomatic infection does not appear to be reduced against BA.2 compared to BA.1. Sorry, I'm still on the prior slide. And so we feel that vaccines are likely to work as well as they did against BA.1. And the other thing we know now is that sotrovimab, the monoclonal antibody we were touting as the one that worked against Omicron, does not work against the BA.2 sublineage of Omicron. Therefore, the FDA repealed it. It is no longer authorized. It was peeled back in certain regions of the United States that had more BA.2, and now that BA.2 is definitely the predominant variant in all regions of the U.S., there are no longer any regions in the U.S. authorized to use sotrovimab, and now bebtelovimab is the monoclonal antibody of choice. And our MOAC has distributed bebtelovimab to all of our hospitals, that is my understanding. So vaccine administration, the picture of our state on the left depicts vaccination rates by county. Of course, the darker blue meaning a county that's more vaccinated. And I took this from the state's COVID-19.ca.gov website. I will tell you that that website is now not updated daily, but it is being updated Tuesdays and Fridays. And when I took the snapshot of this picture, this demonstrates our completion of primary series amongst all eligible people in our county. So anybody 5 years up and older who is done with their two-dose series. And so you see that we are in a medium blue color. Interestingly, if you were to switch the screen and look for people 5 to 11 who have completed their vaccine series, the entire gets lighter, and of course our county gets lighter blue. But if you look at the screen that shows how many people 18 and over have completed their primary series, for our county, we turn that dark blue. So we're doing very well with adult vaccinations. There's another screen you can look at when you're looking at boosters. And for that, we are quite light, almost the white color. So we know we have some work to do with getting folks boosted. Now, if you look at the rest of this slide, you'll see at the top, I'm showing the state numbers, and then the bottom, San Joaquin County. And what the state is now doing on their dashboard is they're showing us how many people are boosted, so that there's a darker blue, and then a dark blue, and a medium blue, and a light blue. So just looking at our county, you'll see that 26.8% of folks have received their booster. So they're done their primary series and they're boosted. Another 31.4% are eligible to be boosted but have not received their booster, but they've had two doses. And then the medium blue, which you don't see a number for, it represents about 6% more of people who've had their primary series, but it hasn't been enough time yet to get their booster, so they're not eligible for their booster. And if you add those up, we're at a 64.3 percentile rate as far as people being fully vaccinated with their primary series. An additional 13.3% of people are incomplete with their primary series, and an entire 22.4% are not vaccinated at all. So a little bit lagging behind state numbers, as you can see, and we are still trying to work with our health equity focus groups and our CBOs to get these numbers up. And next slide, please. So in March, there was news coming out of the FDA and CDC that a second booster was allowed. This is a permissive authorization. It's not a strong recommendation. However, it's considered an allowance for someone who is seeking extra protection. And of course, there are now studies going on to study those people who have moved on to receive a fourth dose to see what protection it has offered them. A little bit difficult to study during a time when we don't have many cases surging. The second booster dose is offered to anyone who is immunocompromised or over 50, as long as it's been 4 months from their second dose, from their third dose, I'm sorry, 4 months from their first booster. And the other thing that the CDC tacked on was that adults who received a primary vaccine and a booster dose of J&J can also receive a booster with an mRNA. Next slide. So I won't go over this table, but just to quickly include it for anyone who wants to refer back to this later to show that the vaccine timing has changed and now reflects that second booster being available to people 50 and over. And next slide. And this is the next slide shows the timing for immunocompromised folks. For immunocompromised folks, the third dose was not considered their booster, but part of their primary series, but they can move on to get a booster and a second booster as well. So people less than 50 who are immunocompromised, Pfizer for 12 to 17 and Moderna down to 18. And next slide. The FDA VRBPAC committee met on April 6th. There were no votes taken during that meeting and no recommendations made. It was simply a very long 8-hour meeting, an extensive discussion that included various speakers, and the topics included the vaccine effectiveness in children and adults, the evolution of variants, future variants, and how do we model for them, and how do we decide what types of vaccines we want to move to market. Monovalent vaccines that might cover a specific sublineage of a variant, or multivalent vaccines such as the annual flu vaccine that might cover several strains. No decisions made, just a lot of talking, but some very nice presentations were made. And I would encourage anyone who wants to see that presentation to just Google it. It's searchable, and you can find the YouTube video of this 8-hour meeting. The next VRBPAC meeting has not been scheduled yet, but they know that they have many things on the table yet to discuss and to vote on. And so by early summer, we're expecting them to have another meeting. Some of the things that they have to discuss would include Pfizer's request to have approval for their vaccine for children less than 5 years old. Pfizer has also submitted a request to have an EUA for boosters to be eligible for kids 5 to 11, and they want their 12 to 15-year-old EUA authorization to move to full licensure. Also on the table is Moderna's request for their vaccine for less than 18 and Novavax's new vaccine for people 18 and over. The CDC's ACIP committee does have a meeting scheduled for April 20. We don't know what they will be discussing as the agenda has not been released. We assume they're going to be talking about boosters and most likely a robust conversation about boosters in adults, perhaps in children as well. So next slide. As I said, that VRBPAC committee meeting was a very lengthy meeting. Lots of science was presented by Dr. Ruth Link Gellis of the CDC. All of the studies she presented were really from the United States, so within the United States, studies called PROTECT, IVY, VISION, and I don't have the time to go through all of the studies right now, but she did have this very nice summary slide which summarized the findings from all of the studies she presented. And it's a bit of a busy slide, but as you can see, they were comparing two-dose vaccine effectiveness against having an infection, needing to go to the emergency department or urgent care or hospitalizations. And again, they did the same with people who had received three doses. And so you can see across the board for anyone receiving two doses, admittedly, there were many vaccine breakthroughs, and so protection against infection was limited. However, higher against emergency room and urgent care visits, and even higher against hospitalizations, though we did see some waning of protection. And notably, in the bottom right-hand corner, you will see that with three-dose vaccinations, effectiveness was substantial and added significant protection against all outcomes, becoming infected, needing to go to the urgent care, or hospitalization. Next slide. Switching topics now to the local quarantine order, which I rescinded on April 11th in response to CDPH's updated isolation and quarantine guidance. I have had an isolation order and a quarantine order, and no other local orders for quite some time. They always mirrored CDPH, but we kept them in order to use them with our contact tracing team whenever we had to send an order to someone who was either positive and needed isolation or exposed and needed to be quarantined. CDPH now, if you look at that table, you will see is not requiring a quarantine of the general public. And again, let me remind you that quarantine is for people who are exposed to COVID-19. They don't have COVID-19, but they are close contacts. Those folks used to have to stay home for 10 days, could be released from quarantine at 5 days if they would test negative. But now there is no quarantine recommendation for the general public, and that is because we know that the predominant circulating virus is Omicron, and Omicron has a very quick incubation period and infectivity period. And by the time many people realize and find out that they've been a close contact, the incubation period has already passed and they've either started demonstrating symptoms or not. Of course, if you're symptomatic, this does not apply to you. But if you remain asymptomatic, there is no requirement for a quarantine. So my order, which used to say you would have to test out of quarantine on day 5, has now been rescinded as there is no requirement from the state. I will let you know that if you look at the CDPH's isolation and quarantine guidance, you see that there's a separate table for certain circumstances that are considered high risk. So congregate settings such as jails and homeless shelters, cooling shelters, emergency centers, those places are still highly recommended to do some quarantining. But again, it was a recommendation and not a mandate. Therefore, there was no longer a need for my quarantine order. Thus, the only order that remains locally that I have is an isolation order, which mirrors exactly CDPH's isolation instructions and is no different and is utilized by our contact tracing team to send out to people so that they can understand what the instructions are. Next slide. And I'm sure you've seen this in the news, but basically the school vaccine requirement has been given a new timeline. This is because the FDA has not fully approved vaccines for 12 to 15. As I said, Pfizer was seeking full licensure for 12 to 17-year-olds, for their vaccine. And the FDA had that meeting but did not make any votes. And we don't know when they're going to be meeting again. Nothing has been scheduled, and they're talking about summer. So recall that the state's precondition for requiring vaccination was that the FDA would authorize them fully. And without the FDA having this on their timeline and us not knowing when this will happen, the state has said that knowing that this will be difficult to implement at the last minute, we are going to put this on pause. So it will not take effect until after full FDA approval and no sooner than July 1, 2023. Next slide. I will say that Senator Richard Pan also pulled back on his bill that was related to that vaccine requirement in schools. I just want to go over testing locations in the county to make it clear that none of our test sites have actually closed. They are all open, and we're trying to keep them open. We did close a couple of months ago before HRSA took away the reimbursement for uninsured. We did close Chavez, Franklin, and Edison schools in Stockton Unified. Their numbers were so very low. They were doing maybe 7 to 10 tests a day with our case rates being so low that the HR support vendor operating those sites was not able to make ends meet. And so those sites did close. But OptumServe has two sites operational in the county, still in Lodi and Stockton. This is a state-sponsored team, so we are not paying OptumServe to be here. This is all funded through the state, and we were given these two sites. They used to do PCRs, but now they have transitioned to doing rapid antigen testing with PCRs available upon request. So rapid antigen is the default. default test if you were to sign up for a test at one of these locations, but both tests are available. And the fact that at the federal level, reimbursing tests done on uninsured folks, because that seems to be stuck in Congress, does not affect this site. This site, being sponsored by the state, is reimbursed through DHCS and is therefore free to all. Anyone who is uninsured can go and get a rapid antigen test or a PCR test at either of these two locations. HR support sites, there are 9 of them. We still have in Stockton Delta College and Stagg High School. We still have Manteca Transit Union, and in Tracy, the West Valley Mall. In Lodi, there are 5 sites. And although Stockton, Manteca, and Tracy are open Monday through Friday, the sites in Lodi are rotated so that one's open on Monday, one on Tuesday, one on Wednesday, one on Thursday, and one on Friday. But they're still operational. These sites have always done PCR testing. But recall that we secured them with rapid antigen tests. What we have now worked out with HR support is an agreement that they will offer rapid antigen tests to anyone complimentary of the county. So an uninsured person can go to an HR support site and receive a rapid antigen test at no cost to them. We also had to work out with HR support the maintenance of these sites because they were in such low demand that HR support really was looking at closing all 9 locations, to be honest with you. So we have been working with them to keep them open as much as possible in case there is a need. But I will tell you that if we are doing very well from a COVID standpoint and we don't see any big upticks in the coming months, you might see that we do have to pull back on some of these sites. The state is saying that in the future, what we're expecting is that 80% of testing will be rapids, and a lot of people will be transitioning to doing at-home testing, and PCRs will only account for 20% of testing. So what we are looking at is also making some more bulk purchases of the at-home over-the-counter rapid tests to be distributed to our cities and through our CBOs, as we know that that's something that people feel very comfortable doing at home now. Next slide, and this is my last slide, is just to show you that in addition to the OptumServe offering PCRs and rapids to anyone, and our HR support sites offering rapids to anyone, recall that we have 2 mobile testing and vaccinating opportunities. One is the SNAP nurse van. So this is shown on SJ Ready calendar-wise, vertically. And you can see, for example, today, the SNAP nurse van is at Public Health Services. And we're saying that it's an SJC PHS mobile event. When you see San Joaquin County PHS mobile event, that is the SNAP nurse van. That van is another state-sponsored van that does vaccinations as well as testing. They've got PCRs and rapids. And again, no cost to anyone to go to a SNAP nurse van. When you see that it's an SJCC, San Joaquin County Clinics event, that would be one of Joan Singsong's team. And they are also doing testing and vaccinating at no cost, and her testing is rapid antigen testing only. So just wanted to share all the opportunities out there that are free to everyone. And that would be the end of my slides. Thank you.